You know, every time you go over a particular scripture, the Lord draws your attention to something else. If every time you go back to a scripture, all you got was what you got from it last year, something is wrong. There's a possibility that you're not growing. Because every time and every year, maybe every month, depending on the frequency, then you go back to a scripture, you get more from that scripture. And I was led into Revelation chapter 1. And this time, what I saw was the revelation of Christ himself. What I saw was who Jesus is in that scripture. And so this morning, all I want to do is to present Jesus to you as written in Revelation chapter 1. If you look at Revelation chapter 1, verse 1, the first few words there says the revelation of Jesus Christ. And then it goes down that chapter. But before I go on, I'd just like us to bow our heads for a minute. And just say quietly in your spirit, Lord Jesus, reveal yourself to me from the scripture this morning. In the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, we're just asking this morning that as we look at Revelation chapter 1, some parts of it this morning, that we will see you in the pages of scripture, that we would experience you from the pages of scripture in a new way and dimension this morning. That you would do something tangible in our hearts and in our outlooks, how we see you and how we respond to the things that happen in our lives and the knowledge of who we see you to be. Speak your word to our hearts this morning. Reveal yourself in our hearts this morning. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. And so this morning I'm speaking on the revelation of Christ. Verse 1a of Revelation chapter 1 says, the revelation of Jesus Christ. But I'm actually going to read from verse 9 to verse 16. And I read, it says, I, John, both your brother and companion in the tribulation and kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was on the island that is called Patmos, for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. I was in the spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice as of a trumpet saying, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. And what you see, write in a book and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia, to Ephesus, to Smyrna, to Pergamos, to Thyatira, to Sardis, to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. Then I turned to see the voice that spoke with me. And having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And in the midst of the seven lampstands, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the feet, and girded about the chest with a golden band. His head and hair were white like wool, and as white as snow, and his eyes like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace. and his voice as the sound of many waters. He had in his right hand 7 stars. Out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in its strength. Praise God. John lived in those days in the midst of great tribulation, in the midst of persecution. Persecution so great that Christians were being tortured and killed on a daily basis. And while on that island of Patmos, with all the trouble he had seen, all the persecution and all the killings he had seen, his attention was refocused when he received the vision, the revelation of Christ. When he received the vision of the unveiled Christ. It's been years, remember, that John has seen Jesus. But immediately he saw him in this vision, he recognized him as the Son of Man. He recognized him as the Son of Man. You will remember in Daniel chapter 7, verse 13 and 14, it says, I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, languages, kingdoms, the one which shall not be destroyed, would see him. Who did John see? He saw the unveiled Christ. Remember that while this is symbolic language, it actually portrays undeniable truth. And I'm going to mention 8 undeniable truth of who Christ is this morning to us. Believing that the Holy Spirit will stir us up in our spirits to worship Christ as he unveils him to us in these few scriptures. If you go back to verse 13 of Revelation chapter 1, the first thing you see, the first thing you see about Christ there is that he's the commanding Christ. He's the commander in chief, is the one in authority. Verse 13 says, and in the midst of the 7 lampstands, one like the Son of Man. Now watch this. It says, clothed with a garment down to the feet and girded about the chest with a golden band. The clothing described that Christ is wearing in this scripture describes the authority of the king. It describes the person of a king. In ancient times, this was recognized as an apparel of authority, an apparel of the one that was in charge, an apparel of one that is high in rank in the society. Someone that maybe a high priest, maybe a king, maybe a prince, maybe a judge. But we see Jesus here as one in authority. Do you know how Jesus saw Christ? As one in authority. Now, do you see Christ as one in authority? Or is it just the words that we speak? Because sometimes we say Jesus is my king, and we say he's the king of all kings. But what you do with kings is that you pay obeisance to them. You worship. You obey. Because kings are authorities to us. And so, may I ask, do you see him as the commanding Christ, the one in authority that you should obey? And do you, when push comes to shove, do you really obey him? Or do you do that that pleases you? Or do you take the path of least resistance? A lot of times when we don't obey is because it appears to be a difficult path to take. And we choose to take the path of least resistance, the easy path. If your life seems out of control, remember that Jesus is the one in authority. He's the King of Kings. He's fully in charge of whatever is going on in your life. In my little experience, as a child of God, I have found out that a lot of times when we think that things are out of sync, when we think that things are out of control, a few days later, we find out that he was actually in control. Even though it seemed out of control when we were going through it, we realize. At some point a few years ago, after 40 something years on earth, I suddenly discovered that Jesus Christ had been in control since the day I was born. I suddenly discovered that all the things that happened in my life, including the decisions that my parents made and the decisions that I made, actually, God was in control of them all. He is the commanding Christ, the one in control. Hence, when John saw him, he wore that robe, that garment, that apparel of authority. I pray that you will let him be the one in authority in your life. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Secondly, if you look at verse 14, you will see the consecrated Christ. It says his head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow. When the Bible talks about this, as white as snow, a lot of times figuratively, it's talking about purity. And here we're talking about the purity of the king. Have you ever seen snow fall before? Definitely in England, you must have. Can you see how pure it is? I remember the first day I ever saw snow. By the way, it doesn't snow in my country. So the first day I ever saw snow, I went outside and danced in it, in the garden, and put my hands out.
Took a picture?
I did take a picture. You wonder where she came from. Purity. The purity of the king. Have you considered the fact that the Lord Jesus is the only one who never had a guilty conscience? Have you considered the fact that he never had to confess a sin because he never committed one? It is his purity that makes it impossible for him to lie. Numbers 23 verse 19 says that God is not man that he should lie. What does this mean? That anything and everything he's ever said to you and he's ever said in his word, they are true. It means you can take them to the bank. It means it's going to happen exactly as he says it. It will. It means that you can depend on his word. If he said it, he would do it. He never had a guilty conscience because he never committed anything. He's never deceived anyone. I've met people that have said to me that they used to be in church, but now they have discovered it's brainwashing and that they were lied to. That's the deceiver, giving false information to people. God does not deceive. He never deceives. He cannot lie. It's worth holding on to him. It's worth waiting for him. It does not matter how long you have waited already. It is worth waiting for him. Because he never lies. And he will perform all that he has said. He definitely will. Now, what do we see again in verse 14? It says, and his eyes like a flame of fire. And I see here a comprehending Christ. A Christ that understands and knows and sees all things. We say omniscient, don't we? That's who he is. Christ's fiery eyes refer to the sagacity of the king. He has deep insight. He has vision that penetrates. We will say today he has X-ray vision. You will remember in Mark chapter 2 verse 8. While the people were reasoning among themselves. And he was asking them, why are you reasoning among themselves? Because he knew exactly what they were saying. He understood what they were thinking in their hearts. Jesus cannot be deceived. He sees everything we do. He sees where we are. You know, we can wear masks and pretend to be who we are not. But he sees through that. He knows the intent of the heart. He knows the motives of the heart. He has what we will call in our contemporary world, X-ray vision. He sees every minister. He sees every member. He observes everything that we do. He sees every secret. He sees in the secret and he sees in the open. He sees the thoughts of the heart. He sees every action. Whatever it is that we are behind the mask, he sees it all, he knows it all. He sees through all the pretenses. We can deceive man, but we cannot deceive God. He knows all things. He sees all things. And thankfully, he understands all things. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews that we do not have a high priest that is not touched by the feelings of our infirmities. Because he's gone through it all. He knows through it. He knows it all. He's experienced it all. Even the ones that are hidden to man, he knows it. He understands. If you look at verse 15, it says his feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace. What would you say you're seeing here? He is the condemning Christ. I know somebody will say, hang on. Jesus doesn't condemn. Yes, I agree. That condemnation I'm talking about is not for now. Right now, he's condemned nobody. It doesn't matter what you have done or what you're doing. Jesus has not condemned you. As a matter of fact, he's reaching out and stretching out towards you. He's reaching out to you. No matter where you think you are, how bad you think you have ever been or can ever be, He loves you beyond that. He's reaching out to you right now and he's saying, come. I have not rejected you. I have not condemned you. Come. And I wonder if there's anyone in this gathering this morning who feels condemned, who feels they have done too much for God to forgive them, who feels that if I were God, I would reject me, who feels, oh, where I am, no one can accept me. I'm here to tell you this morning that he hasn't condemned you. Your parents could have, your friends could have, your colleagues could have, your neighbors could have condemned you. But Jesus has not condemned you. And when we say condemning Christ this morning, we're talking about the wrath of God that is to come at the end of time. We're talking about the fact that there is judgment at the end of time. And that's the reason why scripture says today, salvation has come to this house. It's important that if you do not know him, that today you would make a decision to know him and to begin to love him. It is important that you have not made this decision. Today you can. And it's as simple as what the Bible says in Romans chapter 10 from verse 9. It says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jews and Greeks. For the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. What are you going to be saved from? From that eternal damnation, eternal condemnation that is coming at the end. He is a God of love. He loves us. That's why he went to the cross. And he said, everyone that believes in him will not perish but have abundant life. You need to receive that abundant life. Because at the end of time, if we do not receive that abundant life, there is condemnation. Right now, there is no condemnation. We all have an opportunity to come to him. Please come to him today in the name of Jesus. You see in verse 15, it says, his voice as the sound of many waters. We are talking about a communicating Christ. A Christ that speaks. The Christ that has a voice. And the voice that he has is a voice of integrity. The one that says a thing that brings it to pass. A communicating Christ. A Christ that wants to be in fellowship with you. A Christ that wants to speak to you. You know, a lot of times, even as Christians, we speak to him a lot, but we hardly listen to him. But he's speaking, you know. He wants us to listen to him. There is no formula for hearing God. There is no formula for hearing the voice of the Spirit. You've just got to listen. What we find is that most of the time we do not listen to him. We go before his presence and we talk. And the same second we finish talking, we get out of his presence. We do not wait to hear. He has so much to say to us. And if we would only listen, our lives would become better. If we only listen, our lives will become an enviable one. Because he gives instructions. Because he guides. Because he comforts. Because he counsels. He speaks to us. You only need to listen. He speaks to us. It says the seven stars. Sorry, have I missed? Okay. Voice of many waters. This was the same voice that calmed the storm when the disciples went to him and they said, don't you care, we perish? He calmed the storm. The same powerful voice that is being described here as the sound of many waters. That same voice God in our lives this morning if you will let him. Number 6, it says in verse 14, he had in his right hand seven stars. The seven stars here refers to the sovereignty of the king. The stars are the angels or the messengers of the churches. The risen Lord holds in his very hand this moment his church. He is the one holding his church. Number 6 is the controlling Christ. He says, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against my church. Meaning words. We can do, we can sing, we can pray, we can worship, we can attend church, we can fellowship, we can give, we can do all. We do evangelism, and it is important that we do them. But there's just one person building the church. It's Jesus Christ alone. He's the one building his church. No man can build a church. Hello, come and ask me. The first 2 years of Grace Chapel, I tried to build Grace Chapel. I ended up in the hospital. Because you cannot build God's church, you will crash. I ended up in the hospital with high blood pressure. Because I was trying to build a church that does not belong to me. I was trying to pull things together. You try and build God's church as you are building a scattering. Because it's not your job. It is somebody else's job. You build a little, it will scatter because it's not your job. It's God's job. He is the controlling Christ. He builds his church. This church is in his hands. This church is not your church. It's not my church. It's not the Redeemed Christian Church of God church. It is Christ's church. He controls him. He controls it. And nobody is added to the church except he draws that person. You cannot bring anybody to church. If you could bring anybody to church, this church will be full and pouring out. Hello? No. Is that not true?
Yeah.
Can you imagine how many people you've invited to church? And how? What is the percentage of them that have not come? 99.9. Is it not true? And about 80% have told you, I'm coming next Sunday. And they've been telling you that since 2010. And next Sunday has not come. Because nobody comes to the Lord except he draws them. Guess what? No one can chase anybody from church. No one. He's leaving because God has a different assignment for him somewhere else. Because God is posting him somewhere else. Because the next level of his growth in God is somewhere else. Because the next level where he is supposed to do his ministry is somewhere else. But if he's not receiving from the Spirit's leave, then something has to happen for him to leave. You cannot chase anybody from church. You cannot bring anybody from church. You cannot add to a church. You cannot scatter a church. It is his church. He's in control. He's building his church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. He is the one controlling his church. He's the controlling Christ. Number 7. Is the conquering Christ. If you look at verse 16 again, it says, out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. Out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. Christ holds a deadly two-edged sword that refers to the ferocity of the king. One of these days, the Lord Jesus Christ is coming to do battle with the nations of the world. His weapon will be the word. You know, the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 17, when chapter 6, verse 17, when he was talking about the weapons of our warfare, he says in verse 17, and take the helmet of salvation, and what? And the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And so he had the two-edged sword. If you look at the book of Corinthians, it describes the word of God as a two-edged sword. So he has a two-edged sword in his mouth. When confronting great problems, what weapons are you using? Your mind, your brilliant mind, your problem-solving skills, or is it the NHS, Or maybe it's a solicitor. What weapon are you using when you're confronted with problems? Is it money? Is it manipulation? Is it meanness? Is it intelligence? Or is it the word of God? Do you realize that the solution to every problem that man can ever have is in the word of God? If you know the word of God that relates to your matter, you have victory on that matter. If you do not know the word of God that relates to your matter, you will be full of emotions and cry all the time. You have no direction. You have no peace about it. But if you have the word of God that concerns, for example, if I have some sickness in my body and I get the revelation of the word of God, 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 24 that says, by his stripes I was healed. And I have a revelation of that scripture and I hold on to it. Even if the headache is still there, I have peace. Because I know that that word will be manifested physically in my body. So, do you have the right weapon to fight with? David said, I've been young and now I'm old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his children begging bread. And at that particular point in time, you do not have enough. If you have the word, that word of God, you will be sure, you'll be doubly sure that you will not lack and you will not beg bread. Because God will come through for you. I remember a story I read a few years ago. I can't remember which one of Watchman's books that I read it from. About a couple that were missionaries. And there was this night they didn't have milk for the baby. I don't know if somebody has read that book. They didn't have milk for their baby. They had a baby. And they were praying, God, if we can just have milk for the baby. And it was a dark, snowy night. And someone left his church late that night and was driving home. And the Lord said to him, stop at that store and buy a jug of milk. And he said, but we have milk in the house, but if you say so, I'll buy. He bought the can of milk and he was driving home. And the Lord said, drive past your house and go down 2 blocks. And he drove past his house and drove down 2 blocks. And God directed him to a specific house. And he said, knock the door. And so he knocked the door. He took the can of milk, whatever it is, and knocked the door. As he knocked the door, the man opened the door and said, I don't know why I'm here, but God sent me here with a can of milk. And God made provision for that baby for that night. I have been young. Now I am old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his children begging bread. God will always make provision. You may not have things to throw around, but you will not lack. Because he says so. Because his word says so. And I can continue to mention scripture after scripture to let you know that you have a loaded itinerary. Artillery. Is that what it's called?
Yes, artillery, yeah.
In the word of God to make you a victorious Christian.
Amen.
At the beginning of this year, I shared with you that God said we should pray more, and I didn't know the format he was going to take, but I will tell us more. I was saying maybe we'll pray 1 hour extra after service and all that. Since then, I've been praying about it, and now I know exactly what God wants us to do. I've sent some text messages or WhatsApp messages to some of us about it already. What has he been saying to me for the past 4 months, 3 months? That his children are living defeated lives. Simply because we don't know the word of God and we don't pray the word of God. The devil does not respond to emotions, he responds to the word of God. And so we have to begin to pray the word of God.
Amen.
And so God said, the assignment I'm giving to you regarding prayer, for this year, maybe beyond this year, I don't know, is that you begin to pray scriptures chapter by chapter. And so we're setting up a prayer line. We'll give the details to you very soon, where you can log in on a Saturday night for 1 hour and we'll pray 3 chapters of the Bible. It may not be chronological or sequential, but we're not going to be jumping from Genesis chapter 1 to Isaiah chapter 2. No, we're going to pray the whole scripture, this whole chapter, chapter by chapter. Once a week, and I'm believing God, by the time we have done 52 weeks, which is 1 year, we probably should have done about half of the Bible.
Amen.
So Christians will know the Bible, and Christians will begin to pray the Bible. And I want you to begin to pray about this vision, that God will hold it together and fulfill his purpose with it. But if you know the word of God, you will not fear. Because knowing the word of God means that you know God, you know. If you don't know the word of God, you probably don't actually know God. Because the revelation of who God is in his word. And so you need to know his word to know him. Let's go beyond religion and actually know God. Religion is nothing. Anybody can be religious. You can be religious and come to church on Sunday, and on Monday morning, you are devil incarnate. So it's not about religion. It's about a relationship with Jesus. It's about being a little Jesus here on earth. That people will look at you like they looked at the church in Antioch and say, these ones have been with Jesus. Because we can see the character of Jesus in them. Because we can see the traits of Jesus in them. Because we can see that they are doing the things that Jesus did. It's not about religion. And so you need to pay attention to the word of God for you to live a victorious Christian life. To live a conquering life. We have a conquering Christ who has a two-edged sword in his mouth. And in order for you to be a conquering Christian, you need to take up that two-edged sword and be victorious with it. Lastly, I see in verse 16, it says his countenance was like the sun shining in his strength. His countenance was like the sun shining in its strength. Finally, what did John see? He sees Christ's face shining with the glory. Shining with the glory of God. This refers to the glory of the King. Once that face was marred, that face was spat upon. The Bible says, we looked at him, we didn't want anything to do with him for the state of his face and for the state of his body. But here, John is seeing something else. John is seeing it shining. John is seeing here that his face shines in its magnificent glory. Sees the face dazzling. Sees the glory on that face. Sees the unveiled Christ. He sees the unmasked Christ. See the unadulterated glory of God upon the face of Jesus Christ. What do you see this morning? When you think about Jesus, when you picture Jesus in your mind, when you look at the face of Jesus, when you are thinking about Jesus, do you see that glory that compels you, that is attractive to us? Do you see the conquering Christ? Do you see the controlling Christ controlling his church, being in charge of his church? Do you see that Christ that wants to communicate with you, have fellowship with you, build relationship with you? Do you see that Christ that is going to be the judge at the end? Do you see that Christ that understands and knows and sees all things? The deepest pain, he sees it. The deepest secrets, he sees it. He has deep insight. He has what we call x-ray vision. He can see through, you know, our x-rays sees through our flesh and begins to see the bone that is inside. He sees through motives. Do you see that commanding Christ, the King of all, the King of the whole universe? John, who had gone through a season and a season of persecution of the church, has seen people killed, has seen so much turmoil, has seen so much tribulation, has seen so much persecution. And this moment, what was he seeing? He was just looking at Jesus. He was preoccupied with Jesus. He was preoccupied with Jesus. Because he was preoccupied with Jesus, he did not see or remember the circumstances, the tribulation anymore. He did not see the pain anymore. He did not see the people that were being killed and persecuted and scattered anymore. He just saw glory. He just saw the glory in the face of Jesus. He no longer saw the despondency anymore. He saw the vision of Christ. And because he saw the vision of Christ, he saw the revelation of who Christ is, nothing mattered anymore. Are you looking at the circumstances? And because you are looking at the circumstances, you are missing out on the revelation of Jesus. You are missing out on the revelation of who Jesus is, because you are preoccupied with yourself, preoccupied with your problems, preoccupied with your circumstances. In the midst of your despondency, turn around. This morning I want you to turn around. Turn around and focus on Jesus. Hebrews chapter 12 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. I want you to turn around, turn away from that problem. Turn away from that matter. Turn away from that issue. Focus on Jesus. I want you to just focus and gaze at Jesus this morning. Just begin to look at him. Just begin to look at him. Mary, can you type the word Jesus and project it? Just begin to look at Jesus this morning. With the eyes of your mind, just begin to look at Jesus. Begin to look at the beauty of Jesus. Begin to look at who he is to us and in our world. Begin to look at who he is to his church. Begin to look at who he is and who he can be to you as a person. Do you know him as the 8 C's that I have mentioned this morning? Do you know him as the communicating Christ? Do you know him as the comprehending Christ, the commanding Christ, the consecrated Christ, the controlling Christ? Do you know him as the compelling Christ? Who do you know him as? Or do you just have a religion and go to church? I want you to focus on Jesus this morning. Because in him, everything starts and in him, everything ends. He's the Alpha and the Omega. That scripture said, when we read it at the beginning, the first and the last. In him and by him, everything consists. Everything. Do you want to look at Jesus this morning with the eyes of your spirit, with the eyes of your mind? Just look up at Jesus. Just think about him. Just think about him. If it may help, you may want to close your eyes and just think about Jesus. Forget about the dinner right now. The dinner is not going to burn. Forget about the job that you are going to tomorrow. Just think about Jesus. Just only Jesus this morning. Only Jesus. Let your heart just be focused on Jesus this moment. Let your heart just be focused on Jesus this morning. Just on Jesus. Looking unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus. Whatever your circumstance is, just focus on Jesus. Just for these few minutes, just focus on him. Your focus on him will make every other thing that brings fear and anxiety into your life to vanish. Just focus on Jesus. And would you spend the rest of your life focusing on worshiping him and on serving him? On worshiping him and on serving him alone. And let him do his different aspects of yourself to us this morning. I'm asking, oh God, that you will help us to live our lives from here on in the revelation of that you have given to us this morning. We give you all the praise.